So enhancing the baseline security posture for UK PLC. I'm Robin King. So I run an expansive business of one, which is me, which is fairly recent. And my business is formed largely out of the experiences I've had working in this space for about 15 years or so. And when I sat down in spring last year and thought the time was right to do my own thing, I started to think about the sort of work I'd like to do. And what materialised was helping companies I've worked with in the past, some very skilled individuals, help embrace their view of the world with respect to cybersecurity and progress that. And a learned ex-colleague of mine, when I articulated what I was planning to do, said, well, that's very interesting, Robin, because he said, what you've done, and I was claiming at this point it was by design, not accident, but I think you all know possibly the truth. He said, well, actually, what you're looking at is the UK agenda for a lot of the policy drivers behind cybersecurity, which is about shared risk, particularly through interoperable supply chains, the skills development piece that you've heard Jane and Rob talk eloquently about this morning, and also the need at a government level to ensure that UK PLC is a prosperous nation vested in the fact it's properly and adequately protected and is driving growth out of the skills, expertise and capabilities that it has itself. So therein lies the serendipity of what I decided to do and when I decided to do it. Only a very short background, why me? Well, I've sort of travelled this journey, as I say, for the last 15 years or so, at a time when I started, it was all about information security, just at the point where it's kind of morphing into something that was called information assurance, which added some characteristics in there beyond the usual CIA. And then I arrived at a point almost naively when a consultant that was working for me at the time, who was asked to prepare a description of what we did at a product level for NATO, and he sent me this wonderful one-pager back, which is exactly what I asked for, and I said, John, I really like this, but don't you think cybersecurity is a bit sensationalist? And he said, Robert, you've not been reading the newspapers, have you? Because my terminology in my head that had re-educated myself from security to assurance had been overtaken by what we in the industry had craved for an awfully long time, which was some popular prominence, rather than the thing that people never really heard about. And I think cybersecurity has changed that landscape a bit. So I spent some time eventually working for Kinetic into a product vendor, and then ended up managing a small specialist business where we were supplying high-end, high-assurance capability into the defence and government space. So my perspective here, as much as anything, is around that being a small business operating in that world. So this is a collection of perspectives, of observations, taken from what I was doing in that journey and working with some pretty big and prominent trade bodies. The UK Council for Electronic Business sits as the broker between the UK defence industry and the Ministry of Defence. And the Trans-Global Secure Collaboration Programme has done an awful lot of work over the last 15 years looking at how the likes of the MOD, DOD, Dutch Defence can work seamlessly and effectively and securely with its supply chains. So that's a bit of supply chain context to today. Ooh, pointed over there. So supply chain is really interesting to me, and hopefully these perspectives form some logical sequence that maybe come to life as I progress through. But if we just look at the baseline security posture for UK PLC, you know, what is UK PLC? In many respects, it's a collection of supply chains. It's about organisations operating in an interoperable way, in a landscape and digital environment, it's all about sharing information, in actual fact. The key interception point for our area of interest is how we do that securely and with assurance. So if we look at a generic model for supply chain that really takes us from sort of design and analysis through production, through sales and marketing, through customer engagement, including logistics. You know, the worlds that are looking at this as a problem do very much see it like that, because it's an awfully, awfully difficult one. The one point I will make, and maybe it doesn't come out in the slides, of course, there is a challenge with the vocabulary even at a cybersecurity level, because I think that the real difficulty when you look at that in the context of this is the fact that cybersecurity has somehow enabled us to pigeonhole the problem into an area that most people probably don't fully understand and can happily sit there and not understand it and think it's a difficult problem that we handle differently. The reality is, I think, that it's only about business risk, and cybersecurity it almost becomes a little bit of a distraction rather than thinking about the impact of what it does. I could be owned in cyberspace, but if nobody did anything with it, what do I care? I do care, but it's the impact. If you look at generic risk, it's all about impact. If I have a faulty gene in my DNA, do I worry about that? The only time I really worry about it is if I get a medical condition as a result of it. So I think there's a little bit of a challenge here. Whatever happens, though, when we start to think of cybersecurity as something different outside the scope of general business risk and what happens when it hits, then I think it becomes even more of a challenge. And they businesses constantly then look at the professionals to get that professional view, almost abstracted away from what matters to the business. Whatever happens, though, the supply chain is possibly really well positioned to consider and manage risk effectively, but it hits in all sorts of areas when digital pervades right across its entire duration. I've done an awful lot of work into the Ministry of Defence, and I almost think of them almost sympathetically. They're a huge, complex beast. When they stand up and say, well, and they are tested to say, well, you are nothing more than a logistics organisation, and they aspire to operate efficiently as a really good logistics operation, the end point is probably delivering things of a kind of different effect than putting goods on a vehicle and sending it up the motorway. You know, their logistics includes putting munitions in a far-off land. So there is a subtlety, but they will always come back and say, we move from a point of general information value to things that are very, very important that we have to treat differently. And in government, they're often criticised to say, oh, you're trying to do things special in a different way. The reality is that a lot of their ultimate effect is a classification way above most other government departments. They also sit on spending a budget that's, I think, bigger than in the list of five. It's bigger than the next four put together. So it is quite significant. So in looking at supply chain from an MOD perspective, the DCPP came along, the Defence Cyber Protection Partnership, to say, well, you know, what do we lay down as control measures where we can embrace the whole of the supply chain to do better? So my little cartoon around how difficult was this problem. Well, encouragingly, they decided that DCPP would be vested around contract business, because then they can encapsulate all of its supply chain. And encouragingly, all of those things were out of scope. Great. Maybe then it's not quite as complex a headache as we would believe. However, what was in scope, of course, the things that have to be considered in the risk associated with contracting into the MOD is all included. And that becomes really quite wide-ranging, just at a digital asset perspective, when you've got multiple tiers of organisation trying to do one thing for one end entity. And possibly, whilst this bit might have been encouraging, of course, there was a little bit along the bottom there. If in doubt at all, consider it in scope rather than out, which presents the supply chains when you think of MOD being right down to very small businesses supplying mid-sized businesses that are supplying large businesses that are supplying the end client, and MOD in the UK being part of its own delivery supply chain into NATO, into theatre, with other government agencies and departments operating internationally, it becomes a really quite a complex landscape. That was very defence-focused. And of course, the thing that's probably knocking on the door of all organisations now is GDPR, which from a small business perspective and the implications of it can be as equally challenging and vexing as a really complex supply chain. The thing that appears to be adding in, I'm no great expert, is the concept of accountability, personal accountability. And the thing that is almost for us in the industry that is added in is a fine that really has teeth. I was sitting here in October last year when the Information Commissioner's office presented on that day the fact that TalkTalk had been fined for its breach. I sat on my hands and bit my lip, and I was somewhat disappointed at the extent that the regulator could fine for a second offence, in all honesty, was 10% of what a month later Vodafone were fined for delivering poor customer service. So it doesn't really, in its current guise, have teeth. GDPR will change that. I'm not sure when. I'm not sure what implementation timescales will actually be realistic. But all of a sudden you're into 4% of global revenue and 20 million euros, whichever's greater, that starts to have teeth. So to think about this presentation from the perspective of the smaller company now, because I think our industry has a propensity to talk about skills that feed the larger organisations that may well flow down, but larger organisations have resources deployed explicitly to do this. Smaller organisations don't necessarily. And I put this up and it made me chuckle. I've probably sat in meetings a little bit like that, where the senior responsible owner within an organisation just doesn't really fully understand and embrace and pushes it somewhere else. Is it a technical problem? Is it a compliance problem? The smaller organisations probably don't really have the full embracing concept of compliance in that sense. So the problem, I think, is easing. I think I sat there 10 years ago, no, probably 15 years ago, when the information security assurance agenda was building, and Kinetic at the time commissioned a very, very interesting piece of work with Hendy Management College around setting the boardroom agenda. It's probably a publication that's still around. There was a sister publication around securing competitive advantage, and it was talking about all of these things. And under the Information Assurance Advisory Council, which were promulgating this thinking, I went there 10 years later and they were still talking about the same problems. And I think it has changed. I think larger companies with corporate governance are embracing that. I think the smaller companies haven't yet and are still having this type of discussion. When we think about the small business, let's not underestimate the powerhouse of the economy. Some interesting statistics. I'll let you read those. 4.9 million businesses in the UK, 99% of which are in the SME category, for over 14 million people employed, and almost half of our value of the economy is delivered through small businesses. So when we think about a baseline security posture, we can't talk to an agenda that only addresses one half of the value. We've got to encompass all of it, which means reaching out to these organisations and giving them a mechanism where they can just do better because they have to. The subtlety of that graphic probably is a little missed, but it's a bloody hard place to be in a small business. If you're ever in one and run one, my lack of hair probably is testament to the fact I've done that for an awfully long time in the past. It's very difficult. It's very distracting. It's very challenging. It's difficult to get the right resources in place at the right time to achieve your own business objectives. And this other thing that everybody's telling you need to do something about, possibly your insurance company or possibly your bank, it's a difficult thing to embrace. And we as an industry say, yes, you need to do better. As a small business that's not in this industry, it's not necessarily that obvious. So that's the thrust of my presentation. Candidly, when I saw Cyber Essentials come along, when I'm working in a business of 25 security technology specialists, that some of which was their life's work for the government, we took a look at this and were a little bit disparaging. Is that the best we can do? And I freely admit that I've modified my view over that time, taking that particular business through Cyber Essentials, because what I now believe is that what it does do is achieve that balance between something that's achievable and something that's affordable. Not necessarily affordable in monetary terms, but affordable in resource terms. Because quite often in small businesses, that is the key challenge, if not money. And the fact that, you know, these organisations have been involved and have got to that point, I think is a great thing. I sat in the briefing in 2010 in Cheltenham, where they were given responsibility under this security strategy for not only the technical vulnerability elements of what information security and cybersecurity have become, but also a responsibility within UK government and UK PLC for the prosperity, which is about safe place to do business and leveraging the skills and exploiting the skills and expertise we've got as a national industry base. So, apologies, Steve. I think I've apologised for this one before, but there's a really interesting report. Take a look at it. You'll find it under Lancaster University. They did a little bit of a research piece. I always get comfortable talking about other academic institutions when I'm invited to talk by another one, but I think they all play nicer generally. But take a look at it. It actually found that with a profile of several organisations of different types sitting in the SME community, those that had implemented Cyber Essentials would have protected themselves from 99% of the sort of key vulnerabilities that Rob alluded to earlier, shell shock and heartbleed, which I thought was really quite illuminating. The presentation at 2010 that Ian Levy gave around National Cybersecurity Strategy and the responsibility for GCHQ to own that, he was becoming increasingly intolerant, and now as the technical lead for NSIS, I've noticed in social media he is still increasingly intolerant of poor housekeeping being an excuse or not being an excuse for being breached. And at that time he said, good housekeeping will get to 80% of where you need to be. It takes away the complexity. And I think what Cyber Essentials starts to do is enable us to promote that message down to organisations that don't understand the technical complexities of this space just to do better. So as a small business, put you in the mind there, what am I going to do? If I'm in the MOD supply chain, or increasingly a number of other big supply chains, the legal sector are making a move in this sort of direction, the finance sector are doing the same thing. Okay, I'm a small business, I've got a lens on needing compliance, what do I do? I'll engage the process, I'll tick my boxes, I'll say what I think the assessment needs me to say, and I'm going to get a certificate. I'm going to sit back in some complacent style and think, wow, I'm protected. And that, I think, is a really, really, really big danger. Because the perception from your upstream suppliers, the only question they're going to ask is, have you got Cyber Essentials compliance? And you'll say, yep, I've got that. And they'll say, great, we can do business with you. Are you implementing the controls in an operational fashion? Possibly not. You've answered the questions at one point in time to demonstrate possibly that you understand the nature of the questions being asked and you've got some kind of position against them. I think the reality is that quite a lot of businesses are actually sitting in a seat like that because they're probably not even now cognizant of the risks they are taking because they believe they are properly protected. And when's the train going to come along? If you believe the statistics that were mentioned this morning, I don't quote them anymore, it's most small businesses have been compromised, if not all. And if you haven't been, you will be. That's the sort of truisms that a lot of the learned folk in our industry talk through. However, if we do embrace this thing to add value to us and to make a difference and understand and recognise this is the journey to being better protected, then we derive all sorts of advantages. I'm lowering my business risk. The statistics for SMEs that have been compromised that go out of business in 6 months, can't remember the number, it's high. It's alarmingly high. More than one would be disappointing, but it's a lot more than that. And there are examples in this area of businesses that have been compromised that have gone out. So lowering our business risk, if nothing else, from a business owner, from a responsible business owner, mid-businesses, it might be shareholder responsibility I take. If nothing else, I've got responsibility to my staff, my customers. I've got to make sure I'm sustainable. If you look at supply chain context to that, the big defence contractors get very, very worried when the small guys are unsustainable because they quite often have critical components into major platforms that they can't just go somewhere else for. If I'm making the widget that's sitting in an F-35, chances are I'm going to be one of a few. Lockheed Martin won't be able to switch that on overnight if the small guys are just dead and buried. So risk is a really important issue. The Henley Management Report I alluded to earlier really does state, even back in 10, 15 years ago, that we can use this to actually stand higher amongst our peers in business. There is a competitive advantage there, and if I wish to supply in to a supply chain that's asking me to demonstrate that I've taken this seriously, I have a mechanism to do that now. And I can talk about it, and I become a responsible business. And if I do that, in actual fact, I can probably increase my business value because I'm more sustainable. I'm probably more profitable. I'm probably working more efficiently and effectively. And I've covered my governance requirements. So, how? How do we do this? The next bit of this just talks about particularly my experience. I've got two options. I can go through a self-assessment process. I can look at a series of spreadsheets. I can answer the questions and put them into some kind of response mechanism. And I can capture that in my business as a series of questions answered on spreadsheets amongst dozens, if not hundreds of spreadsheets my business owns. And it becomes another one of those. Is it actually really making a difference? Or in my case, I could pick an application that is more meaningful. And I think this becomes really important. It's the same compliance process. I'm not doing anything different in terms of an external assessment of me and my business. What I'm wanting to do is implement this in a different way for different effect that increases value. And as a business owner, that's really, really important. So if I pick something that's meaningful, just gives me a dashboard view of my compliance status that enables me to interact with it on a more operational basis, to understand the gaps and allocate responsibility for filling those gaps in a more easily managed way, I actually think I start to achieve this. Now, even in my business before, I had all these security professionals in that really knew really what advanced persistent threats were all about and how you go about defending and mitigating them at the highest end of government protected marking. Going through the Cyber Essentials was quite illuminating. And I've seen this reflected back in a number of organisations that have information security managers or are indeed offering information security services outwards. When they start to look at a compliance regime that they're stepping through, it starts to expose some gaps. ABC has dual meaning in this context. Let's make it as simple as we can. Let's make it ABC. Let's make it sequential. Let's make it simply understood. Most importantly, if we do this right, and if we embrace the reasons why we're doing this in the first place, we achieve attitude, behaviour and cultural change, which I think possibly is the biggest challenge we all face in this sector. And Jane alluded to this in some of the CompTIA material. It's really, really important. So if I can get a catalyst that's relatively simple, that starts to get the business to understand what the business has to do, and as employees within the business they're responsible for, I think we get to a different place. We then have the opportunity then to think about just tweaking and redesigning some of our business processes so we can be more secure. So me as a small business, I can start to say to my suppliers, tell you what guys, I'm having to do this, where are you on this? Maybe our procurement process in terms of vendor selection, if I'm running ISO 9001, I'm worried about my suppliers, or I've got a supplier selection criteria. One of the questions I now ask, what about Cyber Essentials? Where are you at with this? I can simply implement it into my process. And even if the answer is no, but I still want to use them, I'm consciously aware of the sorts of things I'm now asking. My behaviour and culture starts to change through a bit of business process. And then what was illuminating for us is just put a simple, two simple things in place, one of which we had, but we extended, which is a simple asset register. Who's got what and what are they doing with it in which department? For small businesses, I guarantee that most small businesses don't have the concept of an asset register. If nothing else, it helps you manage license records to check you're not tripped beyond your Microsoft license or your semantic anti-violence license hasn't run out. Put it into a business asset that has a value and then start to use that as the basis for what you're protecting and how you're protecting it. And the other thing was an incident register. We hadn't got one. And from a compliance perspective, you know, sitting there as a 9001, which is very prescriptive, and we wrote it at the time to reflect what the business did, so it became implementable and it did work, but that was always vested in every year. We'd have an assessor come in and he would take a look at key areas and he was looking for evidence. Got Cyber Essentials and I'm embracing it as something you use and do. And capture the evidence. You will get incidents, and when you get an incident, give it to somebody to own, log it. When did it happen? What was it? Who was affected? What we did? What remediation? Very, very simple approach, but it starts to affect that behavioural culture. If we've got that, then to my point before, this is about business security. It's not about cyber security. It's one, cyber is but one increasingly pervasive and risky way of getting compromised. But if the bad guys are out to get you, what are they going to get you? They want your money. State actors might want you out of business if you are providing the widget into an F-35. Possibly not. They're probably after the intellectual property and design patent for it. But it's about business impact. It really is. And if I've got something that implements the cyber end of that into a tool that my management team can use, we establish a monthly meeting. Me as CEO sitting there with my security manager and my network manager, saying, okay, what did we task ourselves to do this month to make us better? What incidents have we had? What do we need to do looking forward to the next month or the next 6 months or the next year? Because, you know, this is an ongoing challenge and problem, and we aspire to do better and better. In our case, in that defence supply chain, we were specifically targeted towards 27001, in actual fact, because that will be coming down the track. Cyber Essential sits as a major component within 27001. So this becomes a visual management tool that we can look at. It's simple to look at. I'm going to dust off the spreadsheet. I'm going to look at the port and see where we're at. What are the reds? It's red, amber, green. It's simple and intuitive, and at that extent can be more easily embraced. CIA becomes very interesting. I made reference to it in the transition from information and security to assurance. Confidentiality, integrity, and availability. When you talk to the small guys, however, about getting this stuff right, that particular organisation didn't really get it right. With Snowden, of course, got it very, very wrong. Roles and privileges, the security controls just not implemented in a way that would defend them from what they would be really worried about. However, from my perspective, what came alive, and I spoke to some of the guys that were involved at the time about bringing forward Cyber Essentials, I hadn't really considered it. In my world, it was cross-domain security, protecting information flows between secret and restricted systems. Very, very prescriptive. You know, there's a world of standards and knowledge around that. It was about, at that stage, it's about confidentiality and integrity. For most small businesses, I would argue that the biggest, one of those three letters is availability, because as the small business, the impact of anything that takes me out is very, very distracting in terms of the thing I've probably got most finite access to, which is resource. My systems are down and I can't communicate with my customers, or I can't get my bid in at 12 noon on Friday to meet the bid criteria. That becomes really, really, really business critical. My point to small businesses being taken out by adversarial effects of cyber is a really important one, and availability is as important as, if not more so, for those small businesses than arguably any of the others. We could argue in certain businesses that that's not the case, but generally speaking, I found that illuminating to think about cyber as an availability issue, not so much about a security secret protection issue. From a baseline security perspective, I think what Cyber Essentials, or standards generally, has the opportunity to do is put the droplet in the pond. An MOD, I was fortunate to have an open session with Francis Maude when he was in the Cabinet Office, and I thought I'd ask a semi-contentious question, not to alienate him, but just to show I'd been thinking about this. And I asked him if, in the context of the 2010 changes and the responsibility allocated to people like GCHQ, if it's that important, in UK prosperity and protection of intellectual property is that important, why don't you regulate? And it was, oh God, that's as far as contentious as we can get. And he said, well, it's not government's job to regulate, in actual fact, which is a big challenge, because that would make a change. It would make a change. If, however, we can do what the MOD have done, which is say, you know what, for us to get this right, we've made a choice, we're powerful and autonomous enough within government to do this, we will mandate that the entry level for all businesses as part of our supply chain is Cyber Essentials, Cyber Essentials Plus, and then the DCPP controls that sit above that, non-negotiable. You haven't got that, you can't play. And government is starting to embrace that more widely. I think if you're bidding for any Crown Commercial Service contract now, they want to see Cyber Essentials compliance. Having said that, I don't think the drop into the centre of the pond is yet big enough. When Cyber Essentials started, I think their aspirations were 10,000 certified companies within a year. And 3 years on, they've got 3,000. So it's not yet hitting. And we, as an industry, and as somebody that's sold into this industry for many, many years, unfortunately, the first option for most businesses, particularly the smaller ones, is do nothing. I'll take the risk. What we aspire to do now is help them take the appropriate risk and be risk aware to the extent they are motivated to do something about it. The other point here is, and I think events like this start to bring the disparate communities together, you know, the future information security professionals that are businesses that are operating, the academic institutions that are putting some of the bigger thinking, the larger companies that have a corporate social responsibility in many respects to do this stuff. If we can get, as we go and think through UK PLC being more of a community that's facing a challenge, it's the community approach that apparently for widespread adoption has to unite people around a shared goal with a goodwill to do better. So what does this mean? It's about achievability in my view, and about longevity. With Cyber Essentials, I can, you know, if I'm reasonably savvy, I can get into that with the right tool, and I can probably certify myself. There'll be work for me to do. I don't believe any organisation is just going to be compliant in terms of not having done anything, moving into being compliant, and nothing requires to be done. But that's a good thing. It's about exposing the gap. So with some helping resource, and the policies and procedures you need to write down so everybody in your business knows and understands what they should be doing, we can get to that baseline place. What it actually gives us is a roadmap. A roadmap towards a life cycle approach to this thing. Cyber Essentials is a point in time assessment. You know, tomorrow I'm not actually compliant because, well, arguably my business would have changed. My risk profile would have changed, the things I'm doing within the business would have changed, the guy that was monitoring the firewall might be not monitoring the firewall. It's a snapshot view, but you hope that awareness sticks and is embraced. Cyber Essentials Plus obviously gets an external validation of that. Okay, somebody's going to go in and ask you the questions, like I had with my ISO 9001. Well, show me, Robin, show me where it went wrong, show me how you're improving, show me where the gaps are. Show me who's responsible for that particular piece, and let me talk to somebody who's involved in a business process that needs to have a view of what quality or security would actually mean. So we get the external validation, but it's still a point in time, but it actually takes us to the position here, which gives us that that embraced way of starting to think properly about what else we need to do. So Policy Plus, IASME, is a scheme that adds in additional controls over the top of Cyber Essentials. 27001 has Cyber Essentials as a subset of it as a technical control, but is more embracing in terms of my information security management system. DCPP is at a contract level, asking you more controls but sitting on top of Cyber Essentials and Cyber Essentials Plus. And I haven't yet figured out where GDPR is, but what strikes me is it's mandating that you have proper control over the systems within which you're storing the data. What becomes more interesting is, I think, as this awareness grows, I'm externally validated. Yeah, I said I did that. I don't actually probably do that quite right now. I need to embed it into my business. I need to start to think about monitoring myself on a frequent basis. It might not be 24/7. Might not have to be. Depends where you sit in the risk curve. But if I start to embrace this, I've got to do some testing for Cyber Essentials Plus. I've got to do some assessment. If I could move that to a more day-to-day, week-to-week operation, then I'm going to know with some greater confidence that I'm protected now rather than saying I was protected at the point of certification. I think this brings through the ability for organisations to embrace those day-to-day security controls and a way of assessing them. So when I sit down in my monthly management meeting with my team, I can look at the portal for assessment and know the gaps against reassessment, possibly. More importantly, if I'm in this space, I can say, okay, well, what have we experienced now? What can we tune? What are we worried about? What does our risk profile look like? Possibly thinking it's more advanced than most businesses need to be, but they all kind of should be. It's, you know, do I go out today without a coat, or do I look at the risk of rain and actually stick a coat on? It's, you know, as humans, we are making risk assessment judgments all the time. We're just probably not doing it in the context of a business looking at this type of risk. This was a story I loved, which kind of brought this together. I think one of my, I reflected on as I drove down, one of my first pearls of wisdom from Dad was, you know, the chain is only as strong as the weakest link. You know, that just sticks. It's kind of obvious. Probably we all know that. And at some stage we would have understood what that meant. It was a story that there was a presentation that the new assistant director for cyber at the time for CPNI gave. Where he recounted a story of the week before, where he sat in front of an audience of professional services businesses, because they figured out that, you know, from government into government supply chain, the government supply chain at the top level, the defence contractors, the government contractors, probably do this stuff reasonably well. Who knows? But they are aware. They have teams, they have resources allocated, they have processes, they're doing the 27001-like things. And they were becoming increasingly worried about the next tier down, which was the professional services organisations that were feeding the big contractors that had relationships in defence. The concept being, of course, if I want to get to MOD, I don't touch MOD because it's probably too hard. I don't touch BA systems because it's probably quite resilient. I'll look for into that supply chain where the weaker thing. Anyway, they were presenting on this and saying, you know, you need to think about this. You will be a risk to your upstream supply chain. You are where the bad guys will go. So a guy stood up and said, yeah, that's all well and good. He said, I don't have any technical components that are the materially cyber risky thing that I'm supplying. So, you know, what you're asking me to do has a heavy burden financially. And he said, I think in actual fact, I'll probably choose not to do it because I'm comfortable with my risk. The guy sat down. Another guy stood up in the audience and said, well, that's very interesting. He said, you're one of my key suppliers. You were one of my key suppliers, because if you're not taking it seriously, I do, because I know my upstream customers do. That becomes really powerful. The audience were stunned. The assistant director didn't quite know what to say because it all went a bit frosty and moved on. But the story really stuck with me because it just brings to life our responsibilities, that community, that sense of common goodwill that we do really need to embrace. I'm now flashing red. I put this in. I think these guys here adequately covered that. I think there's a bigger risk that we focus skills in our market on the technical and risk skills that we need to serve other businesses, rather than talk about skills generically in every business. The awareness that Jane spoke of is really, really important. We can be a little bit parochial. It's about everybody in a business behaving securely, so they don't click on the bloody link. and are aware and taking responsibility for security that they do personally. They just need to do it on behalf of their business. Going back, way back when, the information security problem was always framed by 80% of the problem is the people. 80% of the opportunity to do better, therefore, is the people. Business process, technology occupying the small bit at the top of the triangle, and unfortunately, many of the vendors have seized the ground, unfortunately, and it has become a technical problem that has skewed that vocabulary. The other thing, the final point is, try not to eat the elephant in all one go. You don't have to do compliance in one fell swoop now. It is acceptable to have a journey to constantly improve. And rather than conceive a map that just looks complicated where I don't do anything, just think about the next stop on the line. Move to that one and you'll get to your destination. And I think there's some really interesting messages in that that we can all give to the businesses that we're involved with or we can influence.